Welcome to Anything But Ordinary with Spooky and Raven. That's right, we're back. Tonight's topic is Unsolved Mysteries, Ghost Ships and Vessels of the Great Lakes and Open Seas. I am your awesome host, Spooky, and here is your other most awesome host, Raven.
Hey, how are you tonight?
I am doing good. How are you?
Good. It's been weird. We haven't been around for a while. We just have so much things going on.
I know, and I've had some health issues, and by the way, I want to thank everyone who sent prayers, good positives, and well wishes to me. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, well, hold on. The thing is, like, it's weird because I was sick for, like, two different times. Like, one was, like, for 4 weeks. The other one was, like, over a week. And then we had, you know, it's just, nah, it was... Now you had your thing, so I'm hoping that we're done with all of that.
Oh, I am too.
For the rest of the time. Because we've like been advertising this show, I think, like two other times where we had to end up postponing it every time. So
I know. Like, I know. Finally. I just hope that finally it's all over with. Whatever that was, it's just now gone through us and it's gone.
Yeah, but we just want to say, hey, everybody who's tuning in, we missed you guys too. And
yes, we sure did.
We were, you know, couldn't wait to come back. There might be a time where we might have to, you know, like, miss a week and then have a show, like off and on a little bit because it's summertime. There are holidays and certain things that means we have to do. So we may not have a show, like, every single Tuesday in the next coming months, but we're definitely going to have shows for sure.
As many as we possibly can.
Yeah, because we have life things that
we
still
have
come
life
up.
Things that we have to do exactly
still come up, but we don't ever plan on like quitting yet. We're still doing shows, so if we disappear for a little bit, it's just like something came up and stuff. But we really do appreciate everybody who's stuck with us, who keep continually to share the show for us, and who's been messaging us and checking on us and stuff. We, you know, we miss you guys too, and we really appreciate all the positive stuff that you guys always say for us. So, but
absolutely,
you know, tonight's topic was something kind of you were looking into, Spooky, a long time ago when we first were going to do this. It was something you were kind of interested in. You're like, hey, what if we do this, you know?
Well, I was looking for something one time, and I came across a documentary about abandoned ships and ghost ships, and I just thought it was so interesting, and I thought that it would be something that maybe our listeners would be interested in.
Yeah, there is so many different, I mean, because when we started to research this and stuff like that, it could have gone in any direction, really.
Yes, it could have.
So we'll probably have another show dealing again with open water when it comes to the paranormal too. Because there's so many avenues that we could have went with this, but we were kind of trying just to stick with, like, a certain theme. But you know us, we'll probably bounce around anyway.
Well, that's true, too.
Because that's what we do. But, you know, I've kind of always found, like, maritime history interesting in general.
Well, did you know that boats were being created and used as far back as 4000 BC, if not longer?
Yeah, I don't know, but I think it was kind of before that, too, because I really think, like, the longest, I think, anybody's ever really known recorded-wise was back, like, in Egypt and stuff, because they first started making, like, what, those canoe-type raft things first, and then they started building vessels for the oceans and stuff. But do you recall, I think it was, like, a few years back, this guy, I can't remember his name, but he published this book. And if I remember right, I think it was called, like, 1421, like, the year China discovered the world. I think that was the name of his title. I can't, like, 100% remember right. But anyways, he claims that, you know, in this book, and he'd been telling people from his research and stuff, that he kind of had, like, proof that the Chinese had discovered the Americas over, like, 70-some years before, like, Columbus did, and I think...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I remember something about that.
Yeah, and I think it was, like, the early... I think it was, like, early 1400s or whatever. This guy, you know, this captain, dude, whatever they called him back then, and his crew, they took, like, several different, like, trips, or, excuse me, I mean voyages, their boats,
yeah.
across the ocean for years that was basically funded by the Ming Empire, or, you know, the dude at that time. This is what this guy was claiming, because he supposedly said he had, like, this proof of this map that he's been showing people, that it was from, like, you know, 14, you know, 14,000 or whatever by the Chinese, but actually there's other people who are saying, no, that's actually like this European map from like the 17th century or whatever. But, you know, needless to say, if this guy's, the stuff he has is actually real or fictional, we don't really know, because a lot of times history's been changed against for us to kind of keep us blind, you know what I mean? But
right.
When I first kind of heard about that, it kind of made me think, or my mind think, of what it would have been like to be one of the first people who did take these adventurous, like, voyages to kind of come upon these strange and untamed lands, you know, because nowadays there really aren't that many really alluring type of adventures any of us can really kind of take where we have the chance to kind of discover anything that's, like, unknown, you know?
Well, except for space or the bottom of the ocean, but both of those have many unknowns. I believe I read somewhere where only like 3% of space has even been explored. And
you can only go so far in the ocean.
Well, you can only go so far out. You know, I mean, what? It's the farthest we've ever gone in a manned ship was like the moon. We haven't really gone any farther than that. And then I read somewhere where it said that the last known unfrontier is actually the ocean, that that just a small percentage of the ocean has even been explored.
Well, yeah, I mean, you can't go too far in the ocean because of the pressure and stuff like that, but like, it would be odd, because like I said, you know, there's so many things that we're into and interested in. History I find interesting too, but even maritime history is really fascinating, mm-hmm. and really trying to really discover what is the real truth, because a lot of stuff wasn't recorded till way later on and stuff like that. But, you know, to be one of these people who go on these voyages and just not even know what's in the ocean, like, who knows what was in the ocean way back in the day before they hunted it or killed everything, you know, maybe there was, you know, really large cryptid type creatures or large fish or whatever. But I mean, to me, like, the lure of like the Great Lakes and like the open sea, that's always been since, you know, people started crafting these vessels. You know, there's always been stories and superstitions of like these phantom ships,
yeah,
and unknown creatures or like bizarre lights, you know, people are seeing out on the waters, or that people even talk about seeing like the USOs, you know, UFOs, USOs. And there's also in the lakes and oceans, people are talking about how there's like these large pyramids even under the water and stuff. So, I mean, all these type of things have been circling for centuries when it comes to the open sea and the Great Lakes and all that stuff, you know?
Right. Well, for some, when they hear a ghost ship, mm-hmm. they think of these phantom ships with an unearthly crew sailing along the waters of the world, and this ghostly crew attacking and terrorizing other ships that cross their way. I lost my train of thought.
Yeah, somebody walked in.
Okay, the term is, I'm sorry. In reality. Mm-hmm. A ghost ship is a ship with no living crew aboard.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is. But sort of like you see in the movies, you know, you just think of these ships just sailing, you know, drifting along the waters or sailing along the waters and then attacking these other ships. I lost my train of thought when somebody walked in the room. I do apologize.
That's why you lock the doors. Stay out, kids. Stay out, people. I'm in the middle of a show. But yeah, when most people hear ghost ship, they're thinking of like a phantom, like ghostly apparition type of thing and stuff. But
exactly.
Actually, the term means something totally different.
The term is also sometimes used for ships that have been decommissioned, but not yet scrapped, or for drifting boats that have been found after breaking loose of their ropes and their moorings, mm-hmm. and they become carried away by the wind or the waves. But there are paranormal things attached to these ships too. I mean, don't get me wrong, but that's just basically what a ghost ship is. It's just a ship uncrewed ship.
Yeah, the crew's missing. Nobody knows if they abandoned it and then cut the ship free to go ashore, or if some weird bizarre circumstances happened and people died and stuff. But the term ghost ship, you know, literally has a meaning where it's just a vessel that has no crew aboard for whatever reason. Exactly. But yeah, it totally, yeah. But, you know, one of the first, when I was researching this a while ago, because we wanted to do this show like weeks ago, but when I was first like looking this stuff up and trying to do whatever, I think one of the first recorded things that I found, but there could probably be more, you know, because you can only find so much, and there's always more after you always do a show. You always find more information after you do a show. I tend to find that out too, and it bums me out. But one of the first recorded things that I saw was like this vessel. It was this crewless vessel. Which I think it was a Japanese vessel, actually, and it was located near Mexico around 1617. But, I mean, who knows? Because people kept seeing that, and they kept thinking it was, like, this ghostly ship, because they kept spotting it for a while, and then it finally showed up in Mexico. But nobody really knows, you know, how many times things like this have been spotted or seen throughout the centuries before they were even recorded, you know. But a lot of time, like you said, you know, maybe these ships get stranded in certain areas that are like inhabited, and then like some wicked storm comes or like a tsunami or something, and then it kind of knocks them loose and then sends them right back out to adrift again. And that's why people keep seeing it. Like, they'll run into it, they'll see it for a while, and then it disappears, and then they never see it again. Then all of a sudden they see it again. That's why they think, well, it must be a ghost ship, it's run by ghostly pirates or whatever. So, but you know, when we were researching this topic, I noticed that there was actually numerous ships that are still out there left to their own fate. You know, they just kind of like, when people get done with boats or whatever, or vessels, sometimes they just leave them for the ocean and let them go. So who knows how many are out there completely right now.
Well, that's right. I just saw this thing on this one ship that was seen off the coast of South America, and they didn't give the name of it, but they said that the crew were all killed by radiation poisoning. And the reason this ship is still drifting around out there is because no government wants to deal with it.
Right. We are going to be talking about paranormal tonight, guys. So don't like be like, oh, they're just going to talk history stuff or whatever, or randomness. But that's just what we do. We talk about a little bit of everything. But, you know, if you're talking about that boat, who would want to deal with it? I mean, you think they would just kind of like wait to see which which country it's going to end up, you know, running aground at, and then it's that country's problem to deal with the radiation and all the other toxic stuff.
Maybe that's what they're waiting for, just to see where it runs aground and what country has to get it out of there. But I also read that the Coast Guard finds abandoned ships quite often, and most found, though, are thought to be used in illegal activities.
Oh, like drug
and then abandoned.
Yeah.
And as late, matter of fact, February 22nd of this year.
Wait. I might be talking about that if you're going to be talking something, if I already have it. You know what I mean?
No.
All right.
I lost my train of thought again. Oh, February 27th of this year, the yacht of a German adventurer. Is that the one you're going to be talking about?
Oh, no, but I did read that, too. They actually had video about that, too. That was creepy.
That was very creepy. It was the shot of a German adventurer, a 59-year-old German adventurer named Manfred Fritz Basserach, was found after being missing for 7 years. Now, Basserach's mummified body was found sitting in his chair by the radio, but for 7 years, this boat has been drifting on the Atlantic Ocean, and that is until it was found by fishermen off the coast of the Philippines. They saw this boat kind of, you know, drifting around out there, kind of erratic-like, but they say that there was no evidence of foul play, and the police theorized that by the way he was sitting at his radio, that his death could have been from a sudden heart attack.
Well, here's the.
But it's just an example, though, of some of what's out there.
But yeah, but listen, I read that too. But then I read a little bit deeper, where the Coast Guard wasn't the first, or whoever wasn't the first people to come on it. And he was actually, they found him. They claimed when they did an autopsy that he had just died about 7 days prior before they found him and claimed it was a heart attack. But it turns out there's a video of this sailing team. Like, they get, you know how they have those sailing races?
A body does not mummify in 7 days.
Well, listen. I'm trying to say they have other stuff that came out to disprove what the mortician or whatever the dude's said. And it's not true. He did not die of a heart attack 7 days earlier. Actually, these people who are in a sailing, racing. I don't remember what they're racing for how long, but, you know, they're sailing through the oceans and... they came upon this boat and they saw the mast was all messed up or whatever. So they were, you know, hollering. I think they were German, if I remember right. And they actually, the guy had his GoPro on and he was taping it the whole time when he hopped on board and stuff, trying to ask anybody here, whatever. And he was reporting back to the people like, hey, I don't think anybody's here. And then as soon as he walked in, he found the guy's body. But actually, they found it a month earlier, but they called the Coast Guard and everybody else, and they told him, continue on with the race, leave it alone, we'll take care of it. Well, they didn't discover it till a month after those guys had already discovered it. So there's no way in heck he had died of a heart attack 7 days earlier.
Right.
That's BS,
And this was a guy, though, that had been sailing his yacht, you know, practically around the world for something like 25, 30 years.
Right. So, I mean, you're going to come on to a lot of things, but when people seem to die out in their boats or pirates attack them or their boats go down in like a wicked storm or something, there always seems to be some like weird energy or something that kind of imprints itself, and water seems to be really like conducive when it comes to that, because that's when people are starting to see these boats that you know aren't there, you know they're sunk, they're destroyed, but they keep repeatedly seeing them for years and years and years in the Great Lakes or even in the open oceans. Like, they go and chase these elusive ships where they sometimes, some of these stories we're going to talk about, they just vanish right in front of their eyes. But most of the people who go after them is because they're salvage dogs or whatever you want to call them, you know what I mean? But the allure to kind of want to catch up to these ships that are adrift at the sea, it's because of their cargo alone. You know, because you got the international maritime law where they kind of say anyone who kind of salvages these abandoned vessels, they're kind of entitled to kind of like a good reward.
But well, they are.
But if the boat is still afloat, it's so much easier for them to want to kind of take it. Whereas if they know where it is underwater, it's a little bit harder work, especially because of the depths and stuff. So I see that's why people go out there and after these things. But there's a misconception when they say, well, if you capture this vessel, you're guaranteed 100% of it, all of it. But that's not true. Basically, the insurance company has to kind of sell it off, and then they'll give you a portion of it. But if you get 100% of it, what's the point of them trying to sell it off? They just tell you to keep the stinking broken ship.
But there is maritime law.
Right.
And also, actually, I believe it's an international law that if you get one of these boats, if you can capture, I hate to use that, but if you can capture one of these boats, you are entitled to a percentage of the value of the boat and the cargo.
Yeah, for sure. But I mean, there's so many things that kind of got us into wanting to talk about this because of all the interesting things that occur when it comes to boats and vessels and all that stuff. And then, you know, that's why we're going to be kind of talking about a little bit of everything. But there's this story that was just circling about here lately about SS Cotpaxi. How do you say that name? Do you remember that?
Cotpaxi.
Yeah. Well, supposedly this vessel was, they found it adrift near like this small island by the Cuban Coast Guard. And they first claimed that they spotted this like tramp steamer in May near one of their restricted military areas west of their Havana or whatever. And when they tried to make contact with this vessel, they claimed they got no response. So they sent out like a couple of their crews to kind of like intercept this vessel. And when they got closer, that's when they realized it was like, oh man, this is like that 100-year-old steamer that's been missing. And so a lot of people claimed that this ship got lost in the Bermuda Triangle and, you know, all that thing about the Bermuda Triangle and stuff. Well, when they got on board, they claimed they kind of looked around and they said that, well, actually, I think a lot of people have hopped on this boat before, because I think they claimed in these stories that I was reading that a couple of people ran across it, but it was abandoned. And then when they tried to tow it in or something, it broke or something didn't work. So it kept going off drift or whatever. So now the Cuban government found it, supposedly, since, you know, it's been over 100 years. And they think that since the first day it disappeared in 1925, it really had, there hasn't been anybody really on it since then. And they claim, like, all these items that belonged to the crew and the captain's logbook, they were, like, all still on there. And, like, the last entry, you know, kind of proves that the date of... this is the exact date when it disappeared in 1925, blah, blah, blah. And nobody's really heard it from, like, 90 years or whatever. And they claim that the captain's logbook was authentic. Anyway, what basically was kind of went up to the last date of what the entry was from when I was reading. It was, like, December 1st of 1925. But on November 29th of 1925, this vessel departed Charleston, South Carolina, and it headed towards Havana, Cuba. Now, the ship had a crew of, like, 32 men, and they were under the command of Captain W.J. Meyer. And they were carrying, I think they said, like, 23 tons of coal, or just like
2,300 tons.
Yeah, like just a ton of coal, you know what I mean? But afterwards, it was reported missing for, like, you know, after 2 days later, and nobody's ever seen it again until recently, where the Cuba Coast Guard claimed that they found it in the restricted area. Now, some blame the ship's disappearance and how it kept reappearing off and on throughout the 90 years in the Bermuda Triangle, because and it was, like, in perfect condition, they were saying. They think that it has to do with something, like, paranormal, because they think it was disappearing in and out of these different, like, time, weird dimensions. These are, like, theories that people are saying, you know what I mean? That's why the boat lasted so long at open sea, because that's a long time to be unmanned where through all the storms and everything else. So they claim that it was possibly going through these different, like, dimensions or whatever, that's what you want to believe. But
kind of like a time tunnel in and out of these time warps.
Yeah, sorry, we're a little rusty, guys. We haven't done the show for, like, a month, so we're just trying to get back into the swing of things. Or they also think, like, maybe the reason why this ship kept disappearing and re-coming back is they claim, oh, maybe it was the Atlantic technology, you know what I mean? Or, like, whatever. But a lot of people think that the reason why this ship, I think, why this ship disappeared has to do with more, like, I think Cuba came and just seized it, took the gold, used the boat, or stashed it off for a while, and then claimed they all of a sudden found it 90 years later adrift. You know what I mean? Because after 90-some years, you got all those different storms. It's set out in different elements. And how can this boat still be afloat in really good condition? You know what I mean? It doesn't make sense to me.
Well, when you stop and think about it, too, there's not that much ocean for it to be drifting around on between Charleston, what you said, Charleston, South Carolina, and Cuba, for it to be drifting 90 years out there without being spotted?
Well, people claimed they spotted it off and on, and that they kept, when they tried to get to it, it kept disappearing right in front of their eyes, like it would just vanish, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's why they thought it was manned by ghostly crew, and that, and they kept saying, they claimed that it was kept going in and out of these different dimensions, you know what I mean? But I think, like, back in 1925, I think somebody came upon the steamer. I think they seized the coal. I think they killed the crew and they kept the ship. And then for whatever political reason or for personal gain, you know, Cuba or whoever just decided to say, look what we found. You know what I mean? So for this, I just thrown this one as a quick one because we have tons of bigger ones that we're going to be talking about tonight. But this is one that you're talking about how it's, a, you know, it's paranormal because it's supposedly been seen and chased after for 90 some years, but every time somebody got close to it, it kept disappearing right in front of them. So they were claiming that has to do with these time rips, and wherever it was popping in and out of, people were have these theories of maybe on the other time rip that it goes into, it's not in the ocean, it's like on some desert, and that's why it kept up so good, or who knows. I mean, because everybody has all these different theories, and you know how me and you, we're gonna present all of them out there. But, I mean, I just thought this one was kind of bizarre, especially, like, all of a sudden, Cuba's like, this is what we found, you know? But what happened to all the coal? What happened?
90 years it's been floating around out there, and we just found it.
Yeah, but all these people kept seeing it off and on, and then right when they get to it, it disappears. That, I thought, was kind of strange.
Well, there are also, you know, there are many ships throughout history that have been found adrift, and when boarded, the crew had been missing or dead. And the most famous is the Mary Celeste. Now, the Mary Celeste was built at Spencer's Island, Nova Scotia in 1861. She was first launched under British registration and was named Amazon. Now, in 1868, she transferred to American ownership and registration and was renamed the Mary Celeste and was used as a merchant vessel. Now, her first captain, Robert McClellan, I'll spit it out, fell ill 3 days later, and his condition worsened. So the Amazon returned to Spencer's Island, and on June 19th, McClellan died. So now a man named John Nutting Parker, what a middle name, took over as captain and resumed the voyage to London. Now, during this time, the Amazon encountered even further bad luck. She collided with fishing equipment in the narrows of Eastport, Maine, and after leaving London, ran into another ship in the English Channel, and the other ship sank. So this ship did not get off to a very good start. Now, Parker remained in command for 2 years, working mainly in the West Indies trade, and in 1863, the Amazon received this new captain, William Thompson. Now, he was in command until 1867, when the Amazon was driven ashore in a storm at Cape Breton Island. And the ship was so badly damaged that her owners just abandoned her as a wreck. Now, Alexander McBean of Glace Bay, Nova Scotia, bought the ship as a derelict on, I think it was October 15, 1867. Now, McBean sold the wreck to a local businessman, and in November of 1868, he sold it to Richard Haynes, who was an American mariner from New York. And Haynes paid $1,750 for this wreck, and he spent another $8,800 restoring it. And he also made himself captain. And in 1868, he registered this vessel as an American vessel under the new name Mary Celeste. Now, in October of 1869, the ship was seized by Haynes creditors, and it was sold to a New York consortium headed by a James H. Winchester. And during the next 3 years, this consortium was made up of members that changed several times. So at least for 3 years, there was no record of the Mary Celeste operating at all during this period.
Yeah.
Now, in early of 1872, the ship underwent a major refit that cost $10,000. And this refit enlarged her considerably. And this increased her length, her width, her depth, and added a second deck. Now, the new captain, also a part owner, was a Benjamin Briggs. And in 1872, he took command of the Mary Celeste for her first voyage to Genoa, Italy. And he had arranged for his wife and infant daughter to accompany him. Now, at this time, you know, sailors were very, very superstitious, and a woman on board was considered bad luck.
Yeah, that was for like a long time like that.
Well, I think it's still that way, really.
Well, then the women would be in the Navy. I mean, there's chicks that are in the Navy. Excuse me, I don't mean to say chicks. I apologize. Us ladies are still, we can be in the Navy, and they've been on ships and stuff, so.
Well, that's true. That's true. Times have changed, you know, but I'm sure that there are some that still hold to this. To this superstition.
Yeah.
Now, they had a school-age son that they left with his grandmother. But anyway, on October 20th of 1872, Briggs arrived at Pier 50 on the East River in New York City, and they loaded 1,700 barrels of poisonous denatured alcohol. And for those who do not know, denatured alcohol is used as a solvent and as a fuel, and it is actually ethanol that had these additives to make it poisonous by making it taste bad or smell foul, or to make nauseating so people don't drink it.
Right. Somebody might have tried anyway.
Well, you know, you're out there on a ship for weeks at a time or months at a time, you know, that alcohol starts looking pretty good to you.
Yeah.
So anyway, On the morning of November 5th, the Mary Celeste left Pier 50 and moved into New York Harbor, but the weather was really, really getting bad, so he decided to wait for better conditions. So he anchored the ship just off of Staten Island. Well, on November 7th, when the weather got better, he left the harbor and he headed out into the Atlantic. Mm-hmm. Now, while the Mary Celeste prepared to sail, another ship, a Canadian ship, the Dei Gracia, that was in Hoboken, New Jersey, was waiting for a cargo of petroleum, and the captain, a David Morehouse, stood there and watched the Mary Celeste go, you know, leave this harbor and go on out into the ocean.
Sail by.
And actually, this Canadian ship was going to follow basically the same route, but they were going to cut off and go down by the Azores. But anyway, when the Canadian ship reached a position midway between the Azores and the coast of Portugal about 1 p.m. on December 4th of 1872, as Captain Morehouse walked out on his deck, the helmsman reported that a vessel, was about 6 miles away, heading unsteadily and heading right toward them.
You know he's drunk then if he's like, dude, check it out. There's a car on the ocean, you know.
Yeah, really.
Stay out of the petroleum. It's not for drinking or huffing or whatever. Anyway, yeah, go on.
Okay, so as these two ships drew closer, he could see that nobody was on deck, and he tried to signal the ship, but got no reply to his signal, so he sent his first mate and a guy named Devino and his second mate, John Wright, to investigate the ship.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they established that the ship was the Mary Celeste because her name was right on the stern. And so they climbed aboard and they found that the ship was deserted. The sails were partly set, but the sails were in poor condition. Some of them were missing altogether. Much of the rigging was damaged. The ropes were hanging down loosely over the sides of the ship. The main hatch cover was secure. And the fore and the lazarette hatches were open, and their covers were on the deck. Mm-hmm. And the ship's single lifeboat was missing.
So what heck? They're like, where is everybody at? You know?
I know. There was about 3.5 feet of water in the hold, which was a significant amount, but they said that it was not an alarming amount for a ship that size.
Well, every ship takes on water when it's going over the ocean for a time.
Yeah, especially then, you know, I mean, they're gonna take on a certain amount of water. The ship's daily log was found in the mate's cabin, and the last entry was dated at 8 a.m. on November 25th, which was 9 days earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And it recorded the Mary Celeste's position off Santa Maria Island in the Azores, which was nearly 400 nautical miles from where the Canadian ship encountered her.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Devino saw that the cabin interiors were wet and untidy from water that had entered through the doorways and the skylights. But otherwise, everything was in reasonable order. And in Briggs' cabin, he found personal items scattered around, including a sheathed sword that was under the bed, but most of the ship's papers were missing, along with the captain's navigational instruments. The galley equipment was neatly stored away. There was no food prepared or under preparation, but they said that they had ample provisions in the stores. Now, there was no obvious signs of fire or violence, and the evidence did indicate that there was an orderly departure from the ship by means of the missing lifeboat.
It almost sounded like you said the wrong word. But how did they know they went orderly off the boat?
I don't know. I wondered about that. How do they know that, you know, somebody didn't yell every man for himself and take off in the boat? Devino reported all of this to Captain Morehouse. And Captain Morehouse agreed to bring this derelict ship to Gibraltar, which was 600 nautical miles away. Now, he divided his crew of eight between the two vessels.
See, here's the thing I'm thinking. How do you know we don't know this other boat didn't hijack and kill all those people and dump them off in the ocean? And
well, when they got on deck, they even found the child's toys. There were toys belonging to his infant daughter on the deck. I mean, everything except for the captain's navigational equipment, which really, if they abandoned ship for some reason, he would probably take those to, you know, kind of help steer toward land or wherever it was he was going. Anyway, Devino, he divided
the boat in.
No, they didn't tow it in. He had a crew of eight, and put four of his men on the Mary Celeste.
Oh, okay.
And to bring the ship in.
Gotcha.
And because both ships were seriously undermanned, you know, this was a slow process. But they reached Gibraltar on December 12th, and the Mary Celeste, which had encountered fog, arrived the following morning. Now, she was immediately impounded by this Vice Admiral Court for salvage hearings.
Yeah.
And since Morehouse, bringing up the salvage deals again, since Morehouse found her and brought her into port, he was expected to be paid very well since maritime law. Because of maritime law, he was entitled to a share of the value of the vessel and the cargo. But in the end, he only received 1,000 pounds, which was only about a fifth of the value of both the ship and the cargo. And after this heated salvage hearing of all these theories of what happened to the crew.
Right.
And some of the judges felt that they met with foul play by hands unknown and possibly by Morehouse. Even Morehouse was suspected of
foul play, but it's
a foul play for the money for this ship.
And the stuff. Well, exactly, because they weren't that far off from them. And
right.
They were trailing very closely behind them. They would have seen people in the water or something. Now, if they're, you know, because I forgot what the heck he said was on board, but, you know, sometimes they get that gas and everything that comes up and you have to hurry, get off the boat quickly. So they, you know, they'd be trailing behind in, like, the rowboats and stuff.
But Morehouse and his
crew would see these people.
Right. And even though they couldn't prove anything against Morehouse and his crew remained suspicious in the public's opinion, basically for the rest of Morehouse's life. Now, the Mary Celeste remains a mystery to this very day. I mean, what happened to the crew? Some of it find it hard to believe that she drifted in open water for this long distance.
Right.
And some believe that the crew, I can't talk for some reason. That the crew, fueled by alcohol, mutinied and killed Briggs and his wife and child and then made off in the lifeboat. But if that was the case, where was their bodies?
The bodies would be dumped in the ocean, and at some point the fish would
eat it. And wouldn't there be blood on the ship somewhere?
Yeah, something. But if they decided to have a mutiny and take off with all the stuff, where were they? The other boat would have caught up enough time to see something. That's why it doesn't make sense, because they weren't that far behind.
Well, there were some that believed that they encountered pirates, but nothing was missing. And there are some that believe that bad weather caused them to abandon the ship, you know, maybe hurricane-type weather, water spouts,
which happened. Yeah, the tornado, they're like tornadoes on the water is what
exactly.
They are.
And, of course, there are those that think Morehouse and his crew killed them all to lay claim to the salvage rights, which... That, like I said, that followed Morehouse for the rest of his life. And the problem is there was no evidence to support any of these theories. Everything showed a neat and orderly abandonment of the ship, but nobody knows why. Briggs, his wife and child, and not any of the crew have ever been found, nor has the lifeboat. And maybe the Mary Celeste was just plagued with bad luck. I mean, she started off with bad luck. Why wouldn't she end with it?
It just doesn't make sense. None of it makes sense to me. And I'm thinking...
Me either.
I think that they probably had something to do with it. They blamed claim on the ship. I think they know more than what they ever admitted to, because it doesn't make sense to me. It's one of those highly talked about ghost ship stories from all time, because we've seen it like on Unsolved Mysteries or like all over the place. People are always talking about this one, but we had to put it in because it's one of the popular ones, you know what I mean? But
actually, when you think of ghost ships,
mm-hmm.
you know, not everybody, but a lot of times the name Mary Celeste comes up because this, to this day, is unsolved, and it remains a stigma. Nobody knows what happened aboard this ship. Nobody knows. If they were off in the middle of the ocean in a lifeboat, chances are the lifeboat somehow sank and everybody died, but nobody's washed up anywhere. There was no sign of anyone being murdered on the ship. There was no blood. Everything seemed to be in an orderly fashion. And the only thing that was really missing, like I said, was the captain's navigational tools.
It makes you wonder, like, what did they encounter? Or was it even... Sorry, my cat's being a little turkey. Like, he tried to pull my earbuds out when we were talking because he yanked on the cord, and now he's pounding on the door. But it makes you wonder, like, what happened? Did they encounter something paranormal? Did they encounter pirates? Did something go wrong with the boat?
Pirates would have looted the ship.
Right.
Pirates would have taken everything, even the cargo, because then, you know, fuel was what was a valuable cargo.
Right. Or, you know, maybe they were just after people for slaves. Who knows? I mean, they would have taken the whole thing, I would have thought.
Well, I would have thought so, too. They would have taken the whole ship, or they would have sunk it after they looted it.
Yeah. There's people who claim, like, maybe they, you know, that comes into the weird conspiracy type of bizarre theories and stuff. Like, there's aliens, or there's some type of time weirdness that happened. There's so many things out there that you can read about this that everybody speculates or talks about.
Yeah. But
I just, to me, I don't know. It seems to, and maybe the guy didn't have anything to do with it, but it just kind of seems too coincidence that he quickly came up on it, didn't see nothing. How did all the people disappear so quickly? You know, he wasn't that far behind. You would have saw something. Something.
I don't know if you believe in bad luck or not, but maybe it was just plain bad luck, because like I said, you know, when the first on the ship's very first voyage,
mm-hmm.
the captain on it at that time within 3 days, 3 days he got sick and died.
Yeah, there are people talking about that because they're talking, you know, because
they ran into fishing equipment leaving to go to Italy. They got over to London, they sunk another ship, just ran right into it and sunk it. That's either it was an incompetent captain or just plain bad luck,
which tends to happen. I mean, do you believe in things like that, like bad luck, good luck? I mean, do you think items like household,
I think people
or
make
boats
their own
or
luck.
Plane?
My honest opinion is I think people make their own luck, but when it comes to...
Do you think household items or boats or planes or cars or whatever, dolls, objects,
someone
anything,
told me
do you
one
think
time
that it can hold some kind of... Well, let me finish my question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Do you think that any of those type of things or any of that could hold some kind of energy about it, thus creating an environment where it would seem like it has bad luck or there is a curse to those who own it or have it or have any kind of connection to it? Like the story of the Mary Celeste and what you're talking about.
I know someone that works on an automobile assembly line, and he told me one time, he said that ever so often, ever so many cars that come off the assembly line, they're called lemons, but he calls them cursed.
Right.
So I know some people believe in it. I think it's just poor workmanship.
But, you know, you know how everything's made up of energy. We're all made of energy.
I understand that, but I believe a person makes their own luck. I don't believe in curses.
Well, let me finish my thought, then you can answer what I'm saying. You're not letting me finish before I say it, so you can answer it. But you know how sometimes everything's made up of energy, and our thoughts are energy. So, like, what if the people who are working on the boat were, like, negative people or whatever? Maybe they could have put that type of negative energy on it. And then, who knows, maybe people who rode the ship or whatever had, like, negative thinking. They believe negative things are going to happen, and maybe thus they kind of set up, their mind subconsciously to create these accidents to happen. Who knows? But well, wasn't this boat called something else before the Mary Celeste, somebody said?
It was called the Amazon.
The Amazon. There you go.
I believe that negative energy attracts negative energy. Yes, I do. I believe that if you're around, like, for instance, if you're around someone negative, you know, all they do is whine and complain, and just everything that comes out of their mouth is negative and stuff. I believe that affects you. Yes, I do believe in that.
Yeah, but, I mean, nobody really knows for sure, like, what happened, but there's definitely a lot of different theories that are going out there. But I know there's like several stories that I read about these phantom like vessels being seen. Somebody said release the Kraken, but sorry, the phantom vessels being seen for centuries in like these open waters of the seas and stuff. But you also have the ones that are on these Great Lakes, and even in the Mississippi they talk about seeing these phantom boats and stuff. Now, I always found that kind of interesting, not just the sea, but the lakes in the Mississippi, because everybody's heard about the Lake Michigan, yet the triangle there, which kind of lies between both Wisconsin and Michigan. Now,
I've heard of that.
Yeah. Now,
triangle, yeah.
Well, yeah, we've done shows on vile vortices and triangles, and I think we might have did a little bit of Michigan on one of them. But there's people who have claimed the sea have had, like, odd things occurring there, similar to, like, the Bermuda Triangle, because they claim that they've seen, like, UFOs, strange cryptids, underwater pyramids, to, like, aircrafts and boats, like, mysteriously disappearing and reappearing often on these Great Lakes. Now, I don't know about, like, you, but I've been on several of the Great Lakes, and I've always been amazed by those freshwater lakes, because they're just so ginormous. And when you're out there and you're visiting these areas, you hear stories. And I've heard stories about, you know, these odd things occurring on these lakes since I was a kid, you know?
Right. And people don't realize it, but these severe storms can come up just as easy on the Great Lakes as they can out on these oceans. So it's, and I know that some people think that, oh, you know, they're up on the Great Lakes. What could happen on a lake? Well, a lot can happen on the lake.
Yeah,
and I have heard stories of phantom ships up there.
Right. Well, one of the popular
ones. I've been by the Great Lakes. I haven't really visited any of them or anything, you know, but I've driven by Lake Erie and
what's that one
out in Vermont? Champlain.
But I've been on Lake Superior and Lake Michigan, and when we first went out, we were on this, when you get on the boat, it's huge, and you're like, wow, this boat's awesome, because it's so huge, and I've never been on a boat so large. But then when you start to head out, the boat gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and the waves get ginormous.
Well, I know that all the Great Lakes do have a certain amount of merchant traffic, but I think Lake Superior has a really... it has a lot of merchant traffic on it.
Right.
So,
it's amazing, and it's actually ginormous. You kind of become really humble when you're on those lakes, and the weather can turn at any time. On one side of the lake, it could be decent. Another side of the lake, it could just be storming, and waves could just be crashing, and you're on these huge vessels, and the time you get out there, it looks like you're just in a tiny rowboat, okay?
Yeah.
And it's hard, but one of the ones that's very popular is the Griffon. Now, I'm sure tons of people have heard this one, but this was like, it was like a 17th century sailing ship that was said to be one of the first sailing ships to ever cruise across the Great Lakes. And I think on the ship's main voyage is when it disappeared, because it set sail from like Green Bay, and this was like the first ship that's ever been on the lakes at that time, that of that size, except for canoes from the natives. You know what I mean? Because they never had anything during, supposedly, we don't know, this is just recorded from history that we're aware of, you know what I mean, that was first to ever really go across that size of sailing across the lake. And they had said that the natives actually warned them that something bad was going to happen before they set sail from Washington Island. They stocked up, I think, like on 6 tons worth of like fur that was, I think, probably like $10,000-$12,000 today. And LaSalle, he decided not to get back on board of the ship because he wanted, that was the captain, he wanted to stay and keep going up and down the rivers and keep, you know, trading and getting more fur and whatever. So he basically sent like six men to crew, you know, six guys to basically run the Griffon and you know, sail it back. And he decided just to, you know, keep exploring whatever the lake shores and the Mississippi River. And it was said that on January 8th of 1678, that's when she was never heard from again. But now there's tons of stories are kind of going about, but people claim that they've been having sightings, have been told for centuries, of they keep seeing this ship. Now, the first was by that of many natives who claimed that they seen the ship, like, silently drifting along Erie, Michigan, and what's that lake? It starts with an H again. I forgot.
Huron,
yeah. But these people, for a while, when the ship, they claimed they thought it was gone. They never heard it from it. And then the natives kept saying, well, we keep seeing this ship floating around and stuff. But nobody ever caught up to it or saw it at the time. Well, then there was other stories coming out that were told by other sailors claiming that they encountered the Griffon many times near the northern part of Lake Michigan. And they said they would approach this vessel, and you, of course, you got to give out that warning to let the ship know you're coming near them or whatever.
Right.
Which was often like bells or whistles or whatever they had. And sometimes, you know, they'd have to use a cannon or whatever, depending what ship it was. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But anyway, and when they kept warning them, hey, we're getting closer and closer to the vessel, and they never heard anything back, you know, that's when they thought, well, maybe there was something wrong. So the closer they got to the vessel, they said right before they even got enough to kind of get aboard or get to it, they said the vessel, the Griffon, would just disappear right in front of their eyes. But,
wow.
I don't know, that's what they're saying, and they've been saying this for centuries. But anyway, for centuries, many people have claimed that they've seen this tall masted sailing ship many a time, but most of the time they always see it near Green Bay, off of Green Bay. And the natives used to claim that the Griffon was kind of like cursed, and they think that the ship possibly sank in a storm, or other people think that maybe the crew stole the cargo and then they burnt the ship and then just hightailed it out of there with like 12, you know, all that. It's like $12,000 worth of money, or, you know, fur, you know what I mean?
Right.
Or something, people think that maybe some hostile natives, I'm not saying this, you're not saying this, destroyed the Griffon because they believed that the Griffon was created to destroy the great spirit of the lake, because this was the first ginormous ship to ever sail across any of these lakes, you know? So, of course, they were very protective and didn't want this. But I read it on some sites.
Well, those lakes were very sacred to them.
Right. I read, you know, the land and earth is very sacred to the natives. But I read somewhere on some sites that they actually found human bones in a cave on an island that many claim they think that might have been the crew of the Griffon. Now, the Griffon is one of the many Great Lakes ships that salvage hunters have been searching for eons, you know. Now, many have claimed that they have actually found parts of her. And one as recent, I think, as I read, was in 2014 by two divers. Now, nobody really knows whatever happened to her, and we may never really know exactly what happened, but many have claimed that over the years, they still see, even up to recently, they're still seeing this strange glowing ship silently sailing through the night, only to vanish every single time something, or another vessel, another ship, another freight, or whatever comes close to her, right before it makes contact, because they feel like sometimes they're going to hit this ship, so they're always, they're doing the warning and everything else, and they can't make contact with this, they're panicking, and then every time right before they come to a near collision, this ship disappears, and it's still occurring all the way up to, I think, like I said, just recently, there's accounts of people having these, because you can go hang out around the Great Lakes and listen to thousands of stories of oddities, of spiritual, like just spirits hanging out there, ghostly ships, things disappearing, UFOs, whatever, cryptids and stuff. There's always things that you're hearing from people who are hanging around the Great Lakes. But there's this other scuba diver, I don't know, he claimed, wait, I can't remember. I've been reading my little notes here to try to get my, because I have little pinpoints to remember what I want to say, whatever. But like I said, they claim they see the ship. Others have claimed they have been scuba diving near the area where they think the ship went down. And while they were underwater, okay, you know, just doing their thing, they're like, what do they call those? Sport divers, I think that's what they call them.
I don't know.
But anyway, when they're under, there's a couple divers who claimed that they, the area where they think the ship went down, when they were underwater, oftentimes when they were, these guys look up, they claim that they see this large ship gliding atop of the water above them. And when the divers surface, the ship is nowhere for them to be seen. So they're always kind of thrown off, like, where did this ginormous ship go to that they saw just go over their head when they're underwater? So it's not just people above the water who are seeing what they think is the Griffon, but there's also divers just recently up in like 2013 and on who have told stories of seeing ships floating above their head that look from that century, and then when they resurface, it's not there. So I find that kind of fascinating, you know.
Well, they would come up, they would see this, and they would come up almost immediately because I think I read that they knew that there should not be a ship in that area, or one was due to go through that area. So they would see this going above them, so they'd go up to see what it was, and there would be nothing.
Right. But certain spots where divers go, I mean, they're not really right out in the open where these ginormous ships should be traveling.
Right.
But you have to put out certain systems, like a buoys and flag type of system, say, hey, a diver's here, whatever.
That's what I thought. I thought that when divers go down, that they put out a buoy or something to let other boats know that there is a diver in the area.
Right. But, I mean, these Great Lakes are vastly deep. I mean, there's parts you can't even go down into.
Right.
You know what I mean? And divers can only go so far, you know, but the areas of where they're scuba diving, these type of ships shouldn't really be in the area, but the ship would have noticed their, because you have all these things that it's the red and orange, and it marks, and they have to have many of them to mark. Clearly, you can tell there's diver. And also, they have a boat up there with other guys who are on the boat, you know, who
right.
have to be on top in case anything happens to the divers and stuff. But I think it's kind of fascinating because the Griffon has a specific look to it. And for people to still kind of see in different spots on the Great Lake a sailing ship from the 17th century, I think it's kind of trippy, you know. But
yeah,
for it to have, and many have reported, supposedly reported, we can't ever tell you if this is true or not, you know, but people do experience things, you know, but For it to have an odd glow to it, I find that fascinating too. But, I mean, to me, I'm thinking they probably, a storm took it down, is what I think, more than
likely.
Which
is most likely what happened.
This is the first ship of that size to ever sail across the Great Lakes, you know, besides canoes. And, like, you can hit any part of a lake, and the weather can quickly change on them. And if it's only a 6-man crew, they probably didn't know how to handle that type of, because they probably never had that
right.
experience yet. So why?
Or they didn't expect anything like that up there.
Exactly. You know, so I could see how quickly something could go south, especially being their, you know, really first time doing it. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Right. Why don't we take a break real quick before we get into the rest of these boats?
Vessels. Ships. And
vessels.
Stuff.
Ships.
Okay, well, we're just going to take a quick 3-minute break. Spooky needs to get water or whatever. So if you guys just want to hang out, we'll be back and finish the second half of our show. So thank you for joining us. Thank you for sharing. And we'll be right back to finish the second half in 3 minutes. Welcome back to Anything But Ordinary with Spooky and Raven. Tonight's topic, ghost ships and vessels of the Great Lakes and Open Seas. We want to thank everybody who's been hanging out with us, and for those of you who just tuned in. Sorry, we're still a little rusty. We haven't done, like, shows for almost a month, so we're just winging it again. I'm Raven, and hopefully Spooky's back with us, too.
Yes, I am.
So, yes, we're here.
Yeah, here. My hands are up. See it?
Yeah. It's tonight's show. It's kind of interesting. We're giving a little history about the boats and then kind of throwing out there what people claim of seeing these strange vessels still hanging around or seeing ghostly entities driving these boats or speculating the theories or whatever else. And right. It's not just from the open sea. It's from the Great Lakes, too.
Right. But
I think you're next. I remember right.
Oh, yeah. The SS Baychimo. Now, this is a story of a true ghost ship. The Baychimo became a notable ghost ship along the Alaskan coast. It was abandoned in 1931, and it has been seen numerous times since then. But the last sighting was in 1969. Now, the Baychimo was a steel-hulled 1,300-ton cargo steamer built in 1914 in Sweden, and it was owned by the Hudson's Bay Company. Now, she was launched in 1914, and she was used to trade provisions for pelts in Inuit settlements along the Victoria Island coast of the Northwest Territories of Canada.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it was first named Angermanufen. I know I ripped the crap out of that.
Hey, that's okay. I'm going to mess up on words tonight, too. We're human.
But, and she was used on trading routes between Hamburg and Sweden until the First World War began in August of 1914. Mm-hmm. And after World War I, she was transferred to the United Kingdom as part of Germany's compensations for shipping losses, and it was acquired by the Hudson's Bay Company in 1921, and they renamed it Baychimo. She completed 9 successful voyages along the north coast of Canada, you know, visiting trading posts and collecting pelts, and on August 1st of 1931, at the end of a trading run, and was loaded with a cargo of fur, the Baychimo became trapped in pack ice. So the crew abandoned the ship, and they traveled over 0.5 mile of ice to the town of Barrow, Alaska. Mm-hmm. And they took shelter for 2 days. Now, the ship had broken free of the ice by the time the crew returned, but it became stuck again on October 8th, and this time it was more thoroughly stuck. So on October 15th, the Hudson's Bay Company sent aircraft to pick up 22 of the crew, and 15 men remained behind. Now, they intended to wait out the winter if necessary. So they constructed a wooden shelter some distance away. And on November 24th, this powerful blizzard struck, and after it blew through, there was no sign of the Baychimo. The captain decided that she must have broken up during the storm and sank. But a few days later, an Inuit seal hunter told him that he had seen it about 45 miles away from their position. So the crewman tracked the ship down, but decided that she was unlikely to survive the winter. So they removed these valuable furs from the hold, and they transported them by air. So the Baychimo was completely abandoned. Now, surprisingly, it didn't sink. And over the next few decades, she was sighted numerous times. People even managed to board her several times, but unfortunately, each time they were either unequipped to salvage her or they were driven away by bad weather. Now, the last recorded sighting was by a group of Inuit in 1969, and this was 38 years after she was abandoned. She was stuck in the pack ice of the Beaufort sea between Point Barrow and Icy Cape in the Chukchi Sea, which is off the coast of northwestern Alaska.
Uh-huh.
Now, the timeline of the sightings are a few days after the Baychimo disappeared on November 24th of 1931, the ship was found 45 miles south of where she was lost, but she was again in the ice pack. Now, after several months, she was spotted again about 300 miles to the east. In March of the following year, she was seen floating near the shore by a man named Leslie Melvin, who was traveling to Nome with his dog sled team. A few months after that, she was seen by a group of prospectors. And in August of 1932, she was boarded by a 20-man Alaskan trading party off of Wainwright, Alaska. In March of 1933, she was found by a group of Eskimos, and they even boarded her, and they were trapped aboard her for 10 days by a freak storm that came up. Now, in August of 1933, the Hudson's Bay Company heard she was still afloat, but was too far out to sea to salvage her. And in July of 1934, she was boarded by a group of explorers that were on a schooner. In September of 1935, she was seen off Alaska's northwest coast. And in November of 1939, she was boarded by Captain Hugh Polson, and he wanted to salvage her, but these creeping ice floes became so bad, he had to abandon her. Now, this was the last recorded boarding of the Baychimo. And after 1939, she was seen floating alone and without a crew numerous times. But this ship always seemed to elude capture. Mm-hmm. I mean, even the Coast Guard was called out when her position was sent to them. Mm-hmm. But by the time they got there, she was gone. They couldn't find her. In March of 1962, like I said, she was seen drifting along the Beaufort Sea coast by a group of Inuit, and she was found frozen in an ice pack in 1969. Now, this was, like I said, 38 years after she was abandoned.
This is amazing, though. How could it not go and ran into an iceberg, cut a hole in its hull or anything? There's just so many things and factors that make you go, what? You know what I mean?
I know. With all that ice, I mean, she was in an ice pack. You know, with all that ice, that pressure from that ice, it's just amazing that she stayed afloat for 38 years.
There's so many factors when it comes to the ocean and the sea and the elements and the weather and the icebergs. I mean, come on, the Titanic went, bam, down it goes, you know?
Yeah.
And this boat's like, it has no crew, but it's like, guess what? You know, it
I can think maneuver. Up there, though.
Seals kidnap the boat or steal the boat and operate it? You know, how does it maneuver perfectly through all of that?
I think being in the ice pack, I've never heard of icebergs up there, but
but you know what I mean.
You know, they trap you, and when these ice packs float away, whatever's trapped in them goes along with them. In 2006, the Alaskan government began work on a project to solve the mystery of the ghost ship of what they called the ghost ship of the Arctic. And they tried to locate the Baychimo, whether it was still afloat or on the ocean floor. Mm-hmm. And it should also be noted that on some of these later sightings, the Coast Guard, like I said, went out to get her location. But when they arrived, it was gone. And even though they searched the area, they couldn't find her anywhere. And to this day, she has not been found. No one knows where she is. And if she finally sank, even her resting place is a mystery.
It's so strange. This one is always, I thought, was fascinating when I ever read it, saw it, you know, briefly here or there on the internet. Always things pop up or someone mentions it or whatever. This story alone, I always thought, I was like, this is trippy, dude. Why? How? You know, there's just some things that just don't make sense.
I'm amazed that she stayed afloat for 38 years in the Arctic Sea.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, but Point Barrow, Alaska is the furthest north place in the United States. It's like 200 miles above the Arctic Circle. You got nothing but ice up there. I don't even think they're even without snow. I may be wrong about that. I don't know anything about Alaska. But this
well,
ship...
Well, we know some things from watching Port Protection.
I watch Port Protection. Yeah. I watch Deadliest Catch.
Alaskan Men or whatever the heck that other show is called. But yeah.
Yukon Man, whatever.
Yeah,
but, I mean, this ship stayed afloat in an ice pack for 38 years that they know of. The ship could still be floating around up there. Who knows?
Someone had a question.
They just haven't found it.
Sorry, I had a question if it's still in your brain. How long did they search and were there any survivors? But I thought everybody left the boat.
Everybody got off the ship. From what I read, yeah. Everybody got off the ship. They abandoned that ship.
Because it got stuck.
This was not a case of the ship found floating out there and the crew was missing. They know what happened to the ship. Everybody got off the ship. Everybody got home. You know, I mean, the ship was just abandoned because the
they got stuck in the ice pack.
The Hudson's Bay Company felt that, you know, the last time that they saw the ship and took the remaining 15 men, they felt that the ship would not last another storm and would not last out the winter. So they abandoned it. They thought it was just stuck in the ice. And I guess that they didn't realize that when that ice moves, the ship's going to go with it.
Well, I was going to say, shit happens, but you know what I mean?
Ship happens, yeah.
I said the T word. It's okay. We can say the S word once in a blue moon. But
Richard and Penny both owe me a dollar.
Yeah. You guys owe her money. We made a bet before the show who was gonna say the S word first, but I did anyway. I just, it's one of those stories I find kind of bizarre.
It is bizarre. I found it bizarre too, but it's but the difference between this particular story and the others that we are telling is that they know what happened to the crew of this ship. The crew of this ship survived. This ship was deliberately abandoned.
Yeah.
And it was abandoned for safety reasons. These people, I think when they went up that way, they were in over their heads. I don't think that they realized exactly the kind of conditions that they were going to be encountering. And they ended up abandoning the ship. And they got the cargo out of the ship.
Yeah. But the fact that it maneuvered itself around for so long.
Yeah.
And it was so elusive. It makes you wonder if wasn't there a report of at least one guy died on that ship?
I thought
one guy, because the elements and everything that happened, ended up dying. So who knows? Maybe he was the one who was
driving
the vessel forever.
From what I read, everybody got off. There was like, at first they took like 22 men off and 15 stayed behind. And those 15 men were going to spend out the winter there if they had to, until that ship was free of the ice. And it was free of the ice for a bit, but then it got stuck even further, or even worse. And they just couldn't break it loose.
Yeah. Well, it's one of those interesting ones or whatever. I should go into the next one before we run out of time, because we still have a bunch to do still.
Yeah.
What the heck? I've lost my place. What one were we doing next?
I think you were going to do the Bannockburn.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. Forgot what the heck I was doing. I got lost in chat for a second. Anyway, that was like the steel-hulled freighter, which was built, I think was like in the late 1800s. And it was built by like this Northeastern Marine Engineering Company, but it was built for the Montreal Transportation Company for Quebec. Anyway, this ship, I think from what I read, she basically sailed the Great Lakes for about 10 years. Now, this vessel, the steel hull freighter, was really easily recognized by everybody who saw her. Different freighters, other ships or whatever, they could totally tell what this boat was, just because of her design. you know, she had a certain design. There was no other vessel at the time that was similar to her. So it was very easy for people to spot off a distance. Oh, we know that's the Bannockburn, or however you say that.
And Bannockburn.
Bannockburn, sorry. So a lot of people knew this ship from a distance. They didn't need to come up close and read the name on the boat to know what it was. You know what I mean? She had a very unique design, and people could tell whatever. Anyway, she was on, you know, she sailed the Great Lakes for about 10 years from what I was reading. But she ended up on November 21st of 1902. She had about 20 men and about 85,000 bushels of wheat on board. Now, she left Port Arthur, Ontario, and she didn't really have a smooth voyage. At one point, she kind of, like, ran aground slightly, but they say she only, like, suffered a little damage. This is one of those other boats where, throughout the years, it always had, like, bad luck. It kept running aground, like, a lot of times throughout her voyages. I'm just like, this captain must suck at boating, because I couldn't believe how many issues this boat kept having. And then it goes with the thing of maybe this boat was cursed too, because of all the bad luck it kept having, how many repairs or this or whatever had to happen to it. Well, on November 21st, when she was leaving the Port Arthur, Ontario, they kind of came a little bit too close to grounding, but they said it only suffered like a little bit damage that time, so they just carried on with her voyage. Now, somewhere near when they got near the Passage Island, this other captain of the Algonquin, I think that was the name of
Algonquin.
Okay, sorry. They spotted her, and they, you know, kind of passed by his steamer, and he claimed when he turned back to look at her later on, it just vanished. Well, he kind of assumed the reason why he couldn't see her anymore is because there was kind of like a fogginess going on, because there was kind of a storm they were going through a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So he just figured, you know, the ship was kind of blocked due to a little bit of the fog, and he didn't really think much more of it. Well, according to some sites, after that, no one really ever knows what happened. He was kind of like the last vessel to kind of really see her, you know, and nobody really knows what actually kind of occurred to make this ship disappear. And they didn't see her for a while, and she never made it to the port where she was supposed to go to drop off this bushel of wheat or whatever. And over a time, you know, because they reported it a couple days later when she didn't make it and stuff. And after time, the only thing they did end up finding was like a life preserver and like an oar that were recovered that had the name of the vessel on it. But people claimed that they were seeing sightings of her still being reported even a month after she had vanished. People claimed that they had seen her boat kind of like iced over as it passed by them. And so they didn't really think it sank or anything, because people saw this freighter steamer going by them, and they just thought, okay, well, the reports were wrong because the boat still, they kept running into this boat for a long time or whatever. And sorry, I'm rusty. I haven't done a show for like a long time.
That's okay. You're doing fine.
Spacey. But there was even reports. There were like so many reports being said that I read on the internet for 6 years after that November 21st date, where people kept claiming they were seeing it. And it was just so many reports that people didn't really think that she must have not have sank, because there were just so many different ships and vessels constantly reporting that saying they kept seeing it. You got to come out here. They just thought it was maybe just a drift. You know what I mean? Without a crew. And one of them was just as recent as 2001. Now, how this ship, that's kind of like how this ship got its reputation as the Flying Dutchman of the Lake Superior, because after decades of sailors reportedly seeing her between Port Arthur, Michigan, all the way up to the Sioux Locks between Superior and what's the other stupid lake area?
Huron.
You know what I mean? So this is one of those bizarre things where this one guy sees it, and they never heard from her again. She never dropped off her load or whatever you call it, cargo. And they reported to the loved ones. Well, I guess they must have went down, because they found the oar and the life preserver, but they never saw anything else. But then days after, months after, 6 years after that, there were so many reports of people constantly seeing this ship, but they could never get up to it. And it also came close to them where they, you know, put the warning whistles, do whatever, and then the ship would never communicate back with them. So they just thought that the ship was just crewless and nobody could ever catch up to it. So that's why this ship got coined as the Flying Dutchman of Lake Superior, you know. And there's people still all the way up in as late, I think, the 2001, where we're seeing reports of people claiming to see this ship when they were out on the lakes.
You know, back then, I don't think, I could be wrong about this, but I don't think that the shipping lanes were marked like they are now. Because I mean, even along the Mississippi River, you know, they got buoys out there marking where the barges can go through. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, deep enough for them.
Well, I don't
because think this is a ship. From what I read about this ship ran aground, not completely ran aground, but you know, slightly ran aground. It mm-hmm. was always hitting the shallows.
Yeah, this boat was cursed. Had bad luck, I told you.
Either that or it had an incompetent captain.
That's what I was saying. Like, for the 10 years that it was sailing the different Great Lakes, right away from the beginning on, it was constantly running into things all the time.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, and it had to repairs and up and
it amazed me they kept the same captain all that time. I mean, you'd think after a couple times of running aground, they would have changed captains on that thing.
Yeah. The thing, this is one of the things that I, you know, I just thought was kind of bizarre. You know, obviously something happened because nobody's ever heard from any of the people who were on the ship. And I think one guy actually even got married right before they sailed off that day, too. So, yeah. But to hear absolutely from nobody ever again, but yet people kept seeing this boat so frequently in just the 6 years of after November 21st of when it disappeared.
And there were quite a few sightings of it in those 6 years, too.
Yeah, well, that's so high that they just assumed that it didn't sink, you know what I mean, at all. And, you know, as recent as 2001, people reportedly seeing this vessel, too, which I don't think it's floating. It has to be.
I don't think it is. I think it went down. Yeah.
By 2001, there's no way. I'm thinking it's residual energy or, you know, type of thing that maybe these people are seeing recently.
Right.
But, you know, the international maritime law, when you were kind of talking about the routes and, you know, now they have a more set up way, whatever.
Yeah.
The international maritime law kind of requires ships that weigh over 300 tons to have a AIS transmitter on board so that they could help keep track of these ships' positions and their course in order to help prevent these vessels colliding. But right. At that time, that system, you know, at the time that this system come out, it's just really limited range, you know, when they had the regular ASI, because it was from ground, you know, from one spot to another spot. Do you know what I mean?
Well, that's why, you know, over the years, they updated their systems. And from what I read, they use a satellite AIS system now. And even though it doesn't have the exact real time like the older ground-based systems did, mm-hmm. they do help far more because of the range. And it's easier now to track the ships across the ocean because of the 15 or so satellites that they have up there.
True. Now it helps them locate those who are missing or, like, might be in dire needs, or at least they kind of have a quick indication of where the ship was last seen, where back in the day, you know, when these ships were in the 18th, 17th century, whatever, you know, they didn't have that stuff. And then these ships, the only way that they had to pre-warn them was, you know, cannons, whistles, and what right. have you, or men being up... what do they call that? The very top where guys climb away.
The crow's nest.
The crow's nest, you know. But even then, it's dangerous, and you don't see it sometimes until you're about to hit these ships. And that's why there was a lot of shipwrecks and stuff back in the days in the Great Lakes and everything else, because they didn't have that. And now they have these ASI transmitters for these larger vessels and stuff. And like you said, that was from ground to ground. And even though, like, the ground to ground one, they have a little bit quicker... way of knowing a little bit faster, where the satellite's just a little bit slower of the exact position, but it's still easier for them to maintain with the vast ocean and everything else. But I don't know. I forgot what the heck I was saying. I'm spacing out because we haven't done a show for so long. I'm like,
Well, speaking of the Bannockburn, Bannockburn being the Flying Dutchman of Lake Superior, that brings me into my next pick, the Flying Dutchman.
Oh, yeah, you got to talk about the Flying Dutchman.
Do you remember the Flying Dutchman from the movie Pirates of the Caribbean? This supernatural ship given to Davy Jones by his love, the sea goddess Calypso. Who gives Jones the duty of ferrying souls who die at sea into the next world for 10 years.
I like the Pirates of the Caribbean movies.
I love those movies.
I mean, they are good for what they are. I'm not like, it's the best movie that was ever made, but, you know.
No, it's not the best movies that I ever made, but I still like them. I didn't like the last one, though, but anyway. Well, the Flying Dutchman is based on the famous maritime ghost ship of the same name, which, according to legend, is doomed to sail the seas for all eternity because its captain cursed God after sailing into this horrible storm off the Cape of Good Hope and vowing to round that cape even if it took him until judgment
day. I gotta just say something. Could you imagine being the guy who's like, man, you just got hired that day to be a part of the crew, and then you get screwed for life?
Mm-hmm.
That'd be my luck.
I think I'd have to go choke that captain. I really would.
He's like,
I'd say, well, sail down here for eternity, I'm going to make it worth it. Well, the myth is believed to have occurred in 1641 when a Dutch ship sank off the coast of the Cape of Good Hope. Now, the Cape of Good Hope is notorious for its weather. You can be sailing through there, and the weather is always, it's always rough seas. There's always, you know, something going on down. I don't know why, but there is. This myth is about a ghost ship that could not make a port and is condemned to sail the oceans endlessly. And it is thought to have originated from the 17th century nautical folktale. Mm-hmm. But sightings in the 19th and 20th centuries report the ship as shining with a ghostly light. Now, the legend has its roots in both Dutch and German folklore. The most popular, the most popular account is about a Captain Hendrik Vanderdecken, who set sail in 1680 from Amsterdam to Batavia in Dutch East India, but disappeared in this gale while circumnavigating the Cape. Now, Vanderdecken disregarded the danger, and he pressed on into this cyclone, and the ship sank, sending all on board to their deaths. Now, as payment for his imprudence, Vanderdecken and his ship are condemned to spend eternity fighting this tempest weather at the Cape. Now, in another version of this tale, a Captain Bernard Falk. That's the guy's name.
Yeah, but you came close to almost saying.
I came close.
Yeah.
Who was recognized for the uncanny speed of his trips from Holland to Java, and he was said to be in coalition with the devil. There is also a third version with the captain's name to be Von Straten, and a fourth account claims that the captain's name was Ramhout Von Dam. Now, in all four of these versions, the ship is actually never named. Actually, the name, the Flying Dutchman, actually refers to the cursed captain and not the ship. And each version of this legend, the stories differ. So, you know, the captain refuses to withdraw in the face of the storm, and some horrific crime happens on the ship, or the crew is hit by the plague and is not permitted to enter any port. But no matter what the story or the cause, the ship and its crew are doomed to sail for eternity.
Yeah.
Now, while there is a wide-ranging belief that the Lost Dutchman is simply a fairy tale, there have been genuine reported sightings of a 17th century sailing ship battling the elements at the Cape of Good Hope over the years.
Wait, now, here's just a random theory. Not even theory, just a whatever, throw out things. You know how let's say this is fictional, and it wasn't even real, but because the story was talked about so much, you know, and sometimes people say, well, you know, if everything's made up of energy and our thoughts are energy, and some people claim, like, sometimes you can create things to become into existence just because if you talk about it so much and you give it something so much energy that maybe they created this paranormal image or whatever you want to call it. You know what I'm trying to say? And thus, that's why they might be seeing it. I mean, there's people who kind of talk about that or think things like that, you know, and maybe that's why they see
ships
something
that enter
like
that shipping lane there around the Cape of Good Hope. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, there's probably one of the crew standing on there saying, oh, gee, I hope we don't encounter the Flying Dutchman. And
no, but
probably brings it to them. I don't know.
No, but I'm just saying, you know how this, you know how you tell stories to your kids, or, you know, and then kids, you know, think of things or dream of things. And all these stories are passed down for so long, and then, or even to other ships, and people are scared of this
that
story.
That eventually they become real?
Yeah. And like an imprint or an image, you know, and then they see it. I don't know how to explain it, but there's people who talk about the possibilities of things like that occurring. You know, it's not physically 100% real, but there's like this, like, I don't even know how to say it. You know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah. I know what you're trying to say, but I can't put it into words.
Yeah. Maybe somebody in chat can.
Maybe they can. Possibly, though, the first publicly testified sighting occurred in 1835 when the crew of a British ship was surrounding the Cape, and they witnessed this ghost ship with a very severe storm surrounding it. And the crew said that the ship appeared to be on a collision course with them, but just suddenly disappeared. Now, as I mentioned before, many people believe that the Flying Dutchman is only a myth or a legend, but there have been reliable claims that the Dutchman was sighted and was agreed by most witnesses, the stories. Now, all the sightings have been in the Cape of Good Hope. Even lighthouse keepers reported seeing her in 1823. The HMS 11 skipper, Captain Owen, logged two sightings in his log. And in 1835, a crew on a British ship saw a sailing ship heading toward them in the middle of a storm. And they said it appeared to be on a collision course with them. And then the ship just suddenly disappeared and was nowhere to be found. In 1881... the crew of the HMS Baychimo, including King George V, saw the ship. Now, the next day, one of the men who saw it fell from the rigging and died. And in 1879,
He must have either been drunk or really startled.
It must have been. Probably scared him so bad he lost his footing.
Yeah.
In 1879, the crew of the SS Pretoria saw the apparition of the ghost ship. And in 1911, a whaling ship nearly struck her before the ghost ship just vanished. They claim that they got just within feet of each other, and all of a sudden the ship just vanished. In 1923, a British Navy crew saw the ghost ship and sent documentation to the Society for psychic research,
forgot what you said.
An office, the fourth officer Stone wrote the findings of the 15-minute sighting. This was a sighting that lasted, like I said, 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And this was on January 26th.
Mm-hmm.
A second officer and a helmsman and a cadet also witnessed the ship at the same time. And Stone even drew a picture of the ship that he saw. Now, in 1939, another sighting of the Flying Dutchman by an Admiral Doentz of a German submarine kept the recorded sightings by the U-boat crews. In 1941, people at Glencairn Beach sighted the apparition ship that disappeared before she collided into the rocks. They said she was headed straight for the rocks and then all of a sudden just gone. In 1942, four observers saw the ship arrive at Table Bay and then disappeared. A second officer, Davies, and a third officer, Montserrat, of the HMS Jubilee saw the Flying Dutchman, and Davies recorded it in the ship's log. Also in 1959, there was a ship that nearly collided with it, and sightings of the ship continue to this day. Even members of the royal family have claimed to have seen it. And it should also be noted that the legend of the Flying Dutchman, while some consider it a folklore or just a fairy tale, some truth to it. It did set sail in 1860 from Amsterdam to Batavia, which is a port in Dutch East India, with a captain, Henrik Vanderdecken, at her helm. Mm-hmm. But it never arrived.
Right, and everything else is just stories, true or not.
Everything else is just stories, but I mean, you know, King Henry V saw it, members of the royal family, the British royal family have seen it, their lighthouse keepers have seen it. There have just been too many sightings of this ghost ship, so it's became known as the Flying Dutchman.
Right. Maybe, like you said, all these stories being told about it, they may have created this type of energy into existence, and that's why it constantly disappears and reappears.
Right.
But there's no solid form to it.
And a lot of people who see it, they said that, you know, for as calm as it's going to get around the Cape of Good Hope, that when they see this ship, it has a severe storm around it, even though the other ship doesn't have a storm around it.
Got its own chaotic energy.
Exactly. Like,
rawr, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, that's kind of that's always been a fascinating story for those who love, like, the sea and maritime history and stories and all that stuff, too. This is another popular one when comes to the phantom vessels and stuff.
The Mary Celeste and the Flying Dutchman are two pretty good, are two pretty well-known
popular
stories.
Yeah. You know, getting back to the Great Lakes, because I'm kind of focusing on the Great Lakes tonight. You're doing, like, the oceans and stuff. But, you know, everybody, you know the Edmund Fitzgerald.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, everybody knows that there's a song out about it and stuff like that. Now, she
I even know when she went down, November 10th, 1975.
Yes, it's probably etched in your head. I actually went to the museum they have in Duluth. And seeing, you know, and write about all this stuff.
This has just been an interesting story with me. I have been fascinated with the Edmund Fitzgerald.
Yeah, it is. It's sad, too, but
it's very sad.
She was a 75 long iron ore freighter, you know what I mean? Now, yeah. She went down in, like, a really bad storm in 1975, which you just said the date, so.
Yeah.
After leaving Duluth, Minnesota. Now, she was heading towards Zug Island in Detroit. And I think the last to hear her transmission, you know, before they went down or disappeared or whatever, was by this guy's name was Arthur M. Anderson, the freighter. That was 15 miles away from her at the time.
Right.
But they were kind of heading in the same direction or whatever. You made me lose my thought.
Sorry.
You're like, I know this. I should make you tell the story. But anyway, I'm not going to go into the whole thing about what she is ready. But basically, everybody on board went down with her. And she rests about 500 some feet below Lake Superior to this day. Now, there have been stories told by other freighters and people on shore and other things, or other smaller vessels, that they claim that they, to this day, they still have spotted or see the Fitzgerald gliding across the waters of Lake Superior. And it's usually, like, right before a bad storm or during or after. You know what I mean? Now, supposedly the first report were, like, 9 or 10 years after the wreck. And somebody had claimed, like a freighter claimed, that they had spotted her like one foggy night, and it was just silently sailing right by them. Now, true or not, if these people are spotting this ship for brief moments of time, I don't know, but I know that it's talked about a lot up by Lake Superior of people spotting it, because the Fitzgerald is pretty much recognizable now. Best because of the song and her story and everything else.
And the thing of it is, too, that there have actually been more sightings of the Fitzgerald since she was found off of Whitefish Bay Point, Whitefish Point there. There just seems to be more sightings of her now. And I always wondered why that was, you know, because she, every once in a while somebody would, you know, report that they had seen the Fitzgerald, but it seems like the reports are more and more now that they actually found her. And I think that maybe some of it has to do with it. Basically, the Fitzgerald is a grave.
Well, it is. And it is a grave because everybody went and down with her, and it was
right. They're still down there.
And they didn't. Know, 29
crewmen.
Right. The only thing they really brought up, I think, wasn't just the. It was the bell or something. I can't
remember.
Right.
They brought up the original bell, and they put another bell with all the crewmen on it down there as a memorial, because the families did not want the bodies brought up. And the people who dove down there to get the bell, they claimed that they had seen bodies in her. But I think that maybe part of the reason why there are reports of her is because they went down and disturbed her.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah, that's why it was, you know, so many years after. And that could have stirred up some type of energy. But I mean, I guess it could be quite possible that this imprint of an energy, you know, like they, you know, how houses, because of the certain rocks or the environment, it records something. Maybe the water too records something and leaves it. And since this was such a tragic event, maybe it could have left behind, you know, like an imprint of this it replaying its last voyage, you know, and maybe that's what people might be experiencing. It's really hard to say when these things occur because, one, we're not seeing it, but and I believe people when they talk about their experiences, because there's so many things that have occurred to people on this planet, it's hard for us to say not, but there's so many people who are saying that they have seen these different ships and vessels and freighters and steamers and 17th century boats and stuff in odd times when they shouldn't be there, you know. But I think possibly, like you said, maybe when they went down, because this is a grave, they might have stirred something up. But also, you know, maybe because of it being such a tragic event, that maybe it just has an imprint of it just doing its last vessel. I mean, to me, you know, but I find it interesting that people
that's very, very possible
claiming
very
possible. That they're seeing the Edmund Fitzgerald. But you also have the Emperor, which was this Canadian steamer, right? Now, it was a steamer freighter. Well, it's a freighter, but with the boilers and all that stuff, whatever. But anyway,
steam-powered freighter.
Yeah, it was built back in the 1900s, and it was sometime in the late 40s, I think in June, that it left Ontario, the Thunder Bay area, and it had like just like a ton of iron ore on it. Okay, now according to some sites online, the captain, I guess somehow there's stories talking about that it was around midnight, I guess he decided to go take a nap and put the ship in the hands of the first mate. Now, due to his fatigue or maybe human error, somehow they sailed the ship aground at the north end of Canoe Rocks, which caused the ship to sink quickly, and it ended up killing 12 of the crew members, including the first mate and the captain, while there were other crew members who were actually ended up getting rescued by the Coast Guard or whatever they called them back then, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Now, many of the bodies were recovered early on, but not all of them. Now, I was reading that sometime in the 1970s, there was a couple sport divers that were diving that ship because it's actually a really popular vessel for divers to go to. They actually discovered a body, and they contacted the officials, and the, like, the Canadian guard or whatever, they came in and they retrieved the body and then, you know, took care of the process, you know what I mean? But right. Since that ship wrecked, the emperor, it's sort of, I think what I read, I think there was already over 400 dives to that specific shipwreck to this date. Now, a lot of divers have claimed to have paranormal encounters while they are exploring her wreckage. Now, one diver, I guess, claimed, like, in the late 80s, while he was exploring the wreck, he saw a man lying on a bunk, and this man turned his face and looked at him. And, of course, it freaked him out, so he left and resurfaced and never went back down to that shipwreck again.
I wouldn't either.
Now, there's other stories of divers having paranormal encounters. And they talk about having these experiences where they're hearing strange sounds. Like, they claim, like, they hear, like, even the boilers and the engine and all that stuff still going. And there's divers who claim that they've heard voices underwater, like, speaking to them. And I think there was another story of this guy. He was, you know, he was down near the boiler engine area or whatever. And he said that he encountered probably, like, one of the engine crewmen, because he was in the engine area or whatever. And he said that this man turned and he looked at him, and he said this man had, like, this blank stare at him, like, just had no facial expression. But he said his eyes were just like black holes. There was, like, just, it was freaky. And he said the spirit just kind of stared at him for a while and then turned and went back to, like, he was doing his routine check of the boilers or whatever you do down there, you know what I mean? So, of course, that guy acts, he's like, I'm out of here. You know what I mean? Now, if these stories are true or not, I don't know. But there's a lot of divers, because this is a very popular place for sports divers to go to, because they're allowed to. It's in, like, a national park area or whatever section. So they're allowed to dive this one, and there's a couple other shipwrecks around there. But there's a lot of divers who talk about encountering ghostly figures and hearing, like, engine noises and things underwater that shouldn't be there, which would make, I think, would be a great topic we should do for a paranormal topic one night. Yeah. Is talking about these underwater experiences from divers. So maybe we should find more stories about that for another show. But I know there are a lot out there, because remember that one show, Destination Truth or whatever it was? Remember with Josh Gates when they used to have that show?
Yeah.
Remember when they went and they went to that Truck Lagoon Island, and when they were diving, they were diving around all that military equipment down there and stuff, and they actually recorded engine sounds.
Oh yeah, that was a boat that went down that had, yeah, that was a boat or a ship that went down that still had military trucks and stuff on it.
Yeah, yeah. Remember, and that was like a really, they were like, we can't believe this, and you could hear it, and they actually captured and they recorded the engine sounds of all these different trucks running underwater that have been underwater for a long time. And then I think they actually even, during that show, they brought it to those TAPS, you know, guys at the time.
Yeah.
And even they checked out the EVT findings, and they thought it was just trippy. You know, so we should do a show on that. We should do, like, more research and do research about divers all across the world from oceans and lakes and whatever, sharing their paranormal experiences and encounters with these shipwrecks and whatever else, too, you know? That would make for a good one, too.
Yeah. I think it would. I think, good idea. I'm writing it down.
Yeah.
Okay, the SS Ourang Medan.
Yeah, the ones, we don't have pictures for some of these boats, so, I mean, just, there is none there.
Well, unlike most stories of ghost ships that are centuries old, this one is just a few decades old. The strange radio message was received by numerous ships traveling along the Straits of Malacca, which is around Sumatra and Malaysia, in either June of 1947 or as late as February of 1948. At the time, the origins of this message, an SOS, which means save our ship, were not known. The message was actually divided into two parts, separated by Morse code that could not be deciphered. Now, those that received this message insisted that the transcript went, "All officers, including captain, are dead, lying in chart room, possibly whole crew dead." And then the second part of it was, "I die." There was no other transmission. Now, two ships, both American, that picked up the messages, they felt compelled to investigate. So with the help of British and Dutch listening posts, the coordinates of the vessel that they thought was transmitting, the Dutch freighter, the SS Ourang Medan, they triangulated, and an American merchant ship, I think it was a Silver Star, was sent to the coordinates. Now, given the contents of the distress calls, the captain of the Silver Star wasted no time in navigating to the new heading. And several hours later, the lookout on board the Silver Star spotted the Medan. And even as the rescue ship pulled alongside, they said they could see no visible signs of life. All of their efforts to contact the crew failed, so the captain of the Silver Star organized a search party. And the moment the search party boarded, they were greeted by this horrible, horrible sight. The decks of the Medan were littered with the corpses of the Dutch crew. And all the victims were found with these wide-eyed horror faces twisted into sheer terror. And their arms were up as if they were trying to fight off something. Even the ship's dog was discovered, and he was discovered frozen like he was in the midst of snarling at something.
That's freaky.
That's very freaky. I mean, all of these dead people, their eyes wide open, you know? And the captain was found on his bridge. Now, the remainder of the bridge officers were found in the wheelhouse and the chart room. And the radio operator, who they presumed sent the distress call, was found at his station. The engineering crew were all found at their stations, and they had the same expressions on their faces. Now, during the search, the rescue party noticed several things that struck them as strange. The local temperature was in excess of 100 degrees Fahrenheit, but members of the team felt this ominous chill coming from somewhere. They said that another oddity was the conditions of the victims. All of them had suffered, but none had any injuries that were obvious. They were also decaying quicker than they should be. And the ship itself really didn't appear to have suffered any damage. And when the search party returned to the Silver Star, the decision to tow the Medan for salvage was quickly decided on. So we're just going to tie a rope to her and tow the ship and all these corpses back. It was only when the ships were tied together that smoke was discovered below decks, specifically in the number 4 cargo hold. So they quickly cut the tow rope, and within seconds, the Medan exploded with enough force that it literally lifted the entire ship out of the water. And then when it came back down, it just sank to the seabed.
Damn. I mean, dang. Dang.
Doggone it.
What?
That's some force to literally lift this ship out of the water. It lifted the entire ship. They said it lifted the entire ship out of the water.
That's jacked up, dude.
Yeah, it is. The first official mention of this incident was made by the United States Coast Guard in May of 1952. Now, this took place, they said, around as late as 1948 when this happened. But it wasn't mentioned until 1952. And in addition to the witness testimony of the state of the crew themselves, the published account added that they were all found with their frozen faces upturned to the sun, staring as if in fear. They said their mouths were gaping open and their eyes were just staring wide open. Now, there are people who believe that this never happened.
What year was this again?
It was 1948.
Okay, somebody just asked. I forgot. Anyway, thank you.
Like I said, there are people who believe that this never happened. And one of the arguments given against this ever taking place was the registry of the Ourang Medan. Officially speaking, though, it appears as though it never existed. The Silver Star was a real vessel, though. And at the time of the Medan was supposed to have been floundering, the Silver Star was operating under another registration called the Santa Juana. The Graceline Shipping Company had bought rights to the ship and renamed it. Now, there are those that believe that the Medan did exist and that the ship was registered in Sumatra. And at the time, Sumatra was a Dutch colony, and it formed part of what is known as the Dutch East Indies. But there are no records that have been produced to back this up. Even Lloyd Shipping Registries and the Dictionary of Disasters at Sea from 1824 to 1962 have found no mention of the Medan.
Mm-hmm.
This professor, Theodore Seersdorfer of Essen, Germany, has spent much of the last 50 years researching this story. And he was the first to mention the names of the American ships that originally went out after the Medan, and often refers anyone interested in their own research to a German booklet that was written in 1954. Now, you have to remember that this ship may not have existed, but yet the United States Coast Guard mentioned it in 1952.
Right.
The book was, the publication of it was, this booklet was by a man called Otto Mielke, and he seems to have known a lot about this so-called mysterious ship. Not only the route it took, but the cargo it carried and the name of the captain. And it establishes the date as June 1947. So like I said, you know, this happened either in 47 or as late as February of 1948. And it has been rumored to have been authenticated by a crewman aboard the Silver Star. And this booklet also mentioned the cargo hold and what might have been stored inside. And according to the booklet, the cargo held potassium cyanide and nitroglycerin.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if this is true, it could explain why there are no official records anywhere, because to have these combustible items on a rough sea...
Yeah, together, too.
Together is considered negligence of the most severe kind.
Right.
And it could also explain the explosion shortly after this salvage attempt.
I can't even imagine that.
And it could also explain why the ship was blown completely out of the water. Now, like I said, there are those who speculate that the ship was actually carrying maybe a more sinister and dangerous cargo, like biological weapons, manufactured by Japanese scientists as the result of the insidious experiments that even the Nazi regime would have balked at, and that these were being smuggled out of Japan. Now, these experiments were known as Unit 731, and it was designed to be a secret research and development meant to create the most dangerous chemical and biological weapons to help establish Japanese supremacy.
Right.
And it was formed sometime in 1932, by this Japanese bacteriologist called Shiro Ishii. And he conducted terrible experiments during the Second World War.
You never know, we might do shows on that kind of stuff too, though, because there's a lot of things that we've talked about that we want to do shows on. It's just
I know,
getting when to I, all I, of them, you know?
When I was reading about this ship, the more I dug into it, the more these facts kept, or these stories, I can't say for sure they're facts, but the more all of this came up that was connected to it. And it is feasible that Unit 731 was smuggled on a nondescript merchant vessel with a foreign crew to avoid drawing unwanted attention to what was taking place.
Yeah, we should write that down, so we should do it. You know, because there's a lot of these things that, I mean, people don't know about a lot of different things, and I think they might find it fascinating, the different aspects and sides of humans. I mean, humans are the most foul, unpredictable creatures out there, you know, but yeah.
If this was the case, though, that they were smuggling all of this out on this vessel, you know, to avoid drawing unwanted attention, then something went horribly wrong, and what was it?
Yeah, what took place?
I mean, there have even been comparisons to the Philadelphia experiment by some ufologists. And there have been all sorts of theories, from pirates to ghosts to race, that have been blamed for whatever happened aboard this ill-fated ship.
Right.
And the unnatural deaths of the entire crew has lent some form of credibility to these and other causes. And although the name of the ship is in question, the ship was real. But what happened? No one can say for sure. They can only theorize. This particular ship, the more I dug into this, I couldn't believe all the things that were connected to this particular ship. And because they're saying, you know, and there are some people in high authority that are saying, oh, it never took place. This ship didn't exist. I think that maybe it did, and I think that it was out there smuggling something.
Well, kind of like what they're talking about, and there's a lot of things all of a sudden didn't happen or didn't exist because of what they were doing or what type of military thing that they were a part of or whatever. That's like typical of, you know, years of
well, they're
practice.
Covering it up.
Yeah, exactly. But,
excuse me, and like I said, the United States Coast Guard officially mentioned this ship in March of 1952. But then after that, you know, everybody is trying to say this ship never existed, but the Silver Star did exist, and there was, and they did find a ship out there with the crew dead. But what went wrong? And then the ship exploded. What went wrong?
Right, there was somebody who wanted us to we have many requests to do the Philadelphia experiment show. So we have to do that at some point too, because we've had like four or five requests now for that. So we do have to do that at some point too, but I definitely think we should dig a little bit deeper on some of these things, you know what I mean? And do shows on it, because there's some people who don't know anything, and then there's some people who totally know a lot. But, you know, sometimes it's people who are, you know, like us and other people out there who talk about certain things, it brings this history that people are trying to forget or re-erase that should be brought to life so that we don't repeat certain nasty things too, you know what I mean? But I don't know, we went 5 minutes over, so
yeah, we did.
Why don't you let our viewers know what we'll first off, we're not going to have a show on July 5th because of the holiday, since you know, we're going to be busy with our own families and stuff like that. But Spooky, why don't you let everybody know what we're going to be doing after the 4th of July? We'll be doing this on the 12th.
Okay. I want to thank our mods for doing a good job. I want to thank Raven for a good show, and I want to thank everybody who is listening and who came in to chat tonight. Thank you so much for coming back and listening to us after we'd been off for so long.
Yeah.
Join us Tuesday, July 12th, when we will discuss Haunted Montana, the Little Bighorn Battlefield, and several other locations said to be visited by otherworldly entities. So tune in as we share stories of ghostly encounters. And thank you for coming. Please subscribe to us, give us a like, and share us with others on any social media site you may be a part of.
Right. I just want to thank you all for coming. Thanks, Spooky, Richard, and Penny and stuff. Thank you guys for sharing us. We'll see you guys after the 4th. We want everybody to have a safe 4th of July. Don't drink and drive.
Absolutely.
Don't drink and drive.
Don't get drunk and play with explosives either.
If you do, be careful. If you want to have show reminders, you can click down on the cogwheel down on the YouTube page here next to Spooky and Raven, and you can click on it, and it should give you reminders. If it doesn't, you can go to our webpage, anythingbutordinary2.wix.com/anythingbutordinary, and you can sign up there for show reminders and emails. I just want to say thank you guys for coming. Thanks for liking us. Thanks for sharing, and thanks for being understanding of when we're not on and stuff because of health issues in life and stuff. We missed you guys, and we'll see you again on the 12th. Everybody have a safe holiday for those who celebrate it.